University, I extend a very warm welcome to distinguished guests, senior professors, colleagues, students, and friends of Neera Bain who have come here today to commemorate her on the occasion of the 10th Dr. Neera Desai Memorial Lecture. This year's speaker for the memorial lecture is Professor Sonia Amin. I request Professor Nisha to come on the dais. Please come. Program. I request you all to rise for the university song.
The memorial lectures have been, and the need for a practice like this to continue. This is not a ritualistic practice where we just meet and we invite speakers, but I think in contemporary times the need to safeguard and to protect spaces like this. So with this brief introduction, I just read out the list of the past scholars we have had. For the first Neera Desai Memorial Lecture, we had Professor Suji Tharoor. For the second, we had Professor Jayanti Ghosh. For the third, we had Patricia Oberoi. Fourth, we had our late Professor Navanita Desai. For the fifth, we had Malvika Karlekar. Sixth, we had Maxine Bunston. Seventh, we had Shanta Gokhale. Eighth, we had Pam Rajput. The ninth, we had Professor Brinda Nawar, the well-known writer. As it is clear that we have had various voices, this has been a platform, a very different kind of a platform. And now I look forward to the 10th memorial lecture. And I request Ursula to introduce and to welcome our guest for today. And for our young audience. And after that, I'll be requesting Professor Amin, after her formal introduction, to deliver
us,
please. Thank you.
Such a renowned scholar like Professor Sonia Amin, and wherever we have shared the poster, everyone we have said, they all of them were of they were admiring the Research Center for Women's Studies for this initiative. When Neera Ben was an institution builder, she grew up in a freedom movement culture. As a child also, she was very active. She was part of the Vanar Sena, which was started by Dr. Usha Mehta. They were in her college days, she was with the socialist, and she was very active in the students' movement. And when she was a socialist, her husband, Dr. A.R. Desai, who was my political guru, and I came to radical movement and the social movement in my school days. He was a renowned Marxist sociologist. And both of them, they played a very important role in mentoring younger generation of revolutionaries. It was in his house that, in their house that we, Indira Munshi, all of us met. There used to be study circle, their house was throbbing with ideas. They were extremely receptive. They were totally, like ideologically, very liberal. They had their own conviction, but they were open, and they were always ready for a dialogue, which we don't find in today's culture, in today's political culture. But that was the time where, right from the radical Gandhians, anyone who was doing critical reflection, whether their moorings were in Gandhism or liberalism or leftism or various shades of Marxism, they all gathered around them. They were the ones who always, Neera Ben, when it comes to personally, Neera Ben was highly influenced by Paulo Freire and Ivan Illich's ideas of deschooling society, and whatever you are doing in your theory, that should reflect in your praxis. She was the first person to have examined women's reality in the Indian context. Her first book, Women in Modern India, was published in 1954. In fact, Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, when she wrote its introduction, she says, "I see the streak of feminism in this book." And that was the time when word feminism was an anathema. Okay, and she was labeled as a feminist in 1954. I was not even born. I was born in 1955. She felt lot of intellectual isolation within the Indian Sociological Association. Many times she was also a point of jest, like any time like sociologists would meet and they would discuss sociological theories, Neera Ben, and they would look at Neera Ben and they said, "Oh, now women's studies will come. She will talk about women. For her, women is everything." And rightly so, because she is now considered to be a mother of women's studies. The first, in 1972, when the Status of Women's Committee was formed because of the UN directive and Esther Bosrup's work on women's role in economic development, all the United Nations had asked all 171 member countries to come up with the Status of Women's Report. Neera Ben was one of the members, along with all the stalwarts from different disciplines, and towards equality report, when it was debated in 1974, the report was ready, but we came in contact with Neera Ben. First, we saw her only as a wife of A.R. Desai. She was very angry. She confronted me once, and she said, "What do you think? Don't I have an individuality of my own?" And that was my first lesson, because when you are an arrogant Marxist, you always see only social transformation and the larger issues, but the interpersonal relationships. Because she was very warm. Anytime anyone went, any activist went, she always gave us hot snacks and she gave us tea, and she was very motherly. And you generally invisibilize this kind of a work, and which we realized. And then she was she played a very important role in that whole debate. She introduced, whenever she came to Baroda, where we were the young activists, Amar is also here, all of us, we had an organization called Study and Struggle. We invited her to talk to, give a lecture, and she spoke about status of Women's Committee report. And she said that what was happening in the Towards Equality report, and she introduced us to women's studies. So from a hardcore economist, I started developing interest in women's studies, and that happened with so many, I can say dozens of scholars throughout the India, even wherever it was, a Kalpana Kannabiran or Trupti Shab. In whichever city she went, and if she stayed overnight, she would be surrounded by so many young scholars whom she motivated. They said, I'm not telling you to give up your parent discipline, but why don't you strengthen and enrich your discipline with bringing in women's concerns? And this is how she would say that, yeah, we can have sociology of women, we can have gender economics, we can have psychology of women, we can have gender in history. And this is how she would, and she was very persuasive. She was not an aggressive speaker. She would speak very slowly. She would allow you to absorb the ideas which she was propagating. She was propounding, and she would create a communication and rapport, and always leave a lasting impression on you with this thing. And what we saw, that she was the first one to start a women's center within the university system. Research, it at that time it was called research unit. She had vice chancellor who was very supportive of her. The same vice chancellor became Dr. Madhuri Shah, became a chairperson of UGC. And then she also sent the directive to all university systems to start Women's Studies Center. So many times these new directors who were appointed from various mainstream disciplines, they did not even have idea Women's Studies ki chidiya ka naam hai, what is Women's Studies. Some thought it was a chocolate making, some thought it was a candle making, some thought it was just a tailoring unit you had to start. So Neera Ben had a Herculean task, and she also got a very good comrade to work with her, Dr. Maitreyi Krishnaraj. Two of them, they always, their egalitarian approach, and some of the sentences I can never forget. They would always say, Vibhuti, any later, when I worked for 5 years in Research Center for Women's Studies, and my boss, they would tell that any letter in regional language, never ignore. Please help them. We have to do hand-holding. So many times they did not know what courses to start, whether it's a BA in Women's Studies, MA in Women's Studies. They said, just share our syllabus. Let them change the name and put their university's name. What is important is that our ideas should go. And she defined Women's Studies as that Women's Studies has, our arm of Women's Studies has five fingers: teaching, training, documentation, research, and extension. And she said that all new Women's Studies centers should do that. This was the place which was throbbing with so many activities, especially the summer school. All teachers in Indian universities, they looked up to research center as an apex body of Women's Studies discourses. And winter school, summer school, any vacation of 7 days or 5 days, they would use it to organize this kind of schools in which scholars from different disciplines would come, and they would, first it was just a paper presentation, and later on they started consolidating it into curriculum development. In 1981, Neera, when it came that why can't we create a national level platform institutionalize women's studies, and Neera Ben took up this challenge, and that was the time I volunteered to be in the core team for organizational work, and it was the first Indian Association for Women's Studies, first meeting of Indian Association of Women's Studies took place in SNDT in this campus. This campus was just built, it was not even used. It started with that conference, and then they realized that they decided to give an institutional form. An Indian Association for Women's Studies was formed. Hundreds of papers were given. Each time in this IIWS conference, they took up different themes, and most of the papers, like some of the important papers, were published in a book form. So we got a volume of literature as a result of that. Another very important aspect of Neera Ben was that she said, if we are doing knowledge construction in English, equal importance has to be given to Hindi and other languages. So translation was a very big thing. In fact, any important documents, whether it was a towards equality report, was translated into Gujarati, Samantha Tarfe, it was translated into Marathi by Sharayu Anantaram into, as a Samantha, this thing, and it was translated in Hindi also. Same thing, National Perspective Plan for Women, or Shram Shakti report, all of them, like we would very frugally use the funding so that at least some amount is there for the regional publications. That was very important, this thing. When research centers started developing and it started, money started chasing research centers. Research center did not have to chase money during her tenure when she was a director. And she got a massive grant. All that grant was so judiciously used for generating literature. If you see the brochure of research center, it is so impressive. That kind of publications, the working paper series or a reading series or commissioned researches which they did, and they came out with a very important body of knowledge construction which helped in seeing women's question in Indian context. So we can see that, and then she also gave a proposal to the Vice Chancellor that she wanted to, whatever ideas of women's studies were discussed in the classroom, they should be taken to the people, to the community. And then there was one that Vice Chancellor, UGC chairperson's sister, who was a collector in village called South Gujarat, Udwara, they started a rural development department. SNDT's rural development department got expanded. There also they started a training center for women in the rural areas. So what we saw was that there was a combination of theory and praxis. And the more she started achieving in life, more, and she was being such a humble person, she became a role model of many of us when it comes to taking women's question everywhere. We have to create the communicate channel. We can't be in ivory tower. We should reach out to people. All those things which Neera Ben said, they are still this thing. And that's why we have seen that wherever you go in India, people know about not only her books. She has lived with us not only by her writings and her publications, but also she, the kind of persona that she had, and I think we should take this message. And now we have a very able leader of Research Center for Women's Studies in Dr. Putul Sate's persona. And that's why I think we are so happy, because there was a time where we were worried that if our generation after that, what will happen? But now it is in able hands, and she is also carrying forward the same ethos. And it's a moment for us. It's both emotional moment, and it's also, it generates hope that women's studies has a bright future.
Such a nice words about RCWS, and also sharing your views and experiences with Neera Ben, and helping us understand more about Neera Ben. And it is in fact the kind of people around us, like Vibhuti Ben and others, senior people sitting over here, that we could learn the kind of feminism propagated by Neera Ben, or what exactly she meant by feminism, or the political agenda behind women's studies and all these things. Because of, we could see, we were not very fortunate like our previous generation people who could work with Neera Ben and could understand. But it is through these people's eyes and their sharing their experiences that we could make an attempt to understand the legacy or the heritage left by Neera Ben, and her ideas and passion for women's studies and also the equality, women's justice and empowerment. So thank you, ma'am, for being with us and sharing your memories. Now I request today's keynote speaker, Professor Sonia Amin, and the theme for her lecture is The Life and Work of Rokeya Sakawat, Pioneering Reformer and Writer of Colonial Bengal. Before I request her to give her keynote address, it's my privilege to introduce her briefly. Dr. Sonia Nishan Amin is a former professor of history in Dhaka University, Bangladesh. Even after her superannuation in 2018, Dr. Amin continued taking up teaching assignments. She teaches in North South University, Dhaka, Bangladesh. As regards her academic excellence, Professor Amin is a PhD in history, MA in sociology from Northeastern University, Boston, USA, and MA in history, University of Dhaka. She is a rank holder throughout her academic career. Dr. Sonia Amin has served in various positions of responsibility in Department of History, University of Dhaka from 1984 to 2018. She has served in other important positions as well, such as visiting fellow in Arthur Lim and Jules Chair, University of Hawaii in 2008, editor-in-chief ADAB News, a bi-monthly development journal in English published by ADAB Dhaka for the year 1984, as teaching assistant and subsequently as a part-time lecturer in the Department of Sociology, Northeastern University, Boston from 1978 to 1982. She taught historiography, history of the Middle Ages in Europe, ancient civilizations, international law, gender and history, history of South Asia. She has to her credit several research publications, book reviews, literary compositions, and translation work. She has written extensively on colonial history of Bengal, Muslim women in Bangladesh, women's history and historiography, women of Bengal. Some of her writings include monographs on Dhaka Nagar Jibani Nari, Women in 400 Years of Dhaka's History in 2011, The World of Muslim Women in Colonial Bengal in 1996. She has covered wide-ranging themes in her writings, such as her forthcoming article, From Fairy Tale Protagonist to Television Heroine, The Story of Kiran Mala, The Emergence of Muslim Bhadra Mahila, Cultural Symbols as Resistance, The Shahbagh Movement. Nahi Devi Nahi Samanya Nari, Women in Tagore's Short Stories, and many more. The list is very long. Her literary publications include Under the Lemon Tree, Short Stories by Women from Bangladesh, Janmasthan Darshan, a collection of feminist short stories in Bengali, Boston Diary, KK, a non-fiction novel based on memories of the US, Deep Within the Heart, translation into English of a book of poems. She's been invited for talks and lectures by prestigious institutes across globe. She has presented papers on significant themes like Rokeya, her life and career at the Institute of Social Studies, Dahej, 2005, South Asian Writing and Memories of 1971, Desire and Taslima Nasreen's Poetry at the International Conference in Sri Lanka, and many more international conferences, workshops, and seminars in which she has participated and presented papers. Dr. Amin is the member of various organizations and the recipient of many fellowships and awards. Some of these are, she is the recipient of the Atahar Hossein Gold Medal for the best research book on women's studies for the period 1997-98, awarded by the Asiatic Society of Bangladesh. She is the visiting fellow for the Colonial University's South Asia program, Commonwealth Academic Staff Postdoctoral Fellowship from 1999 to 2000 in London University, Writer in Residence at Sanskriti Pratishthan, New Delhi in 2002. She is the Member Board of Trustees, National Museum of Bangladesh from 2013 till date. So let's welcome Professor Sonia Nishan Amin and listen to her.
Ladies and gentlemen, Respected Chair, Professor Vibhuti Patil, Head of the Research Center for Women's Studies at SMDT, Dr. Putul Sakhe, colleagues, comrades in the cause, students. It's a great honor for me to be giving the Neera Desai Memorial Lecture. She is, to me in distant Dhaka, a foremother and a mentor whom I had never seen in person, but of course whom I had met through the pages of a book. So needless to say, it is an immense honor for me, and I heartily thank Dr. Putul Sakhe, whom I met very coincidentally in Kolkata, for extending this invitation to me, and thanks to the center and to the university, SMDT, for making this trip possible. Just a sentence about my first trip to Mumbai, which I grew up knowing as Bombay, from my parents, who were nurtured on the movies of Raj Kapoor and Vaijayanti Mala and Nargis. And as a child, I would sit and gaze and, you know, wonder. They were able to instill that magic into me, the magic of Ae Dil Hai Mushkil Jeena Yaha. Zara hatke, zara bachke, ye hai Bombay meri jaan. And it's amazing that, of course, we are very Bengal centric. We Bengalis, I know that. But though I have visited the south of India, and I have relatives in various places in India, Calcutta is like a second home, I have never come to Maharashtra. So it is indeed a rare experience for me. And after my lecture today, I'm devoting 3-4 days to getting to know very briefly the tip of the iceberg, I'm sure, your beautiful city. About the lecture, I would say that for some strange reason, Putul was very thanking me profusely for coming. I don't know why I should be the one thanking her. But on a different note, I think it's very important for women to network again if we want to uphold the legacy of mentors like Neera Desai and Rokeya, Sakawat, Hossein, and those who have left us in body but are with us in spirit. Given the present state of affairs in all of South Asia, I won't be so self-congratulatory as to say that we women are the beacons of hope and all that, but Carl Sagan did say that the world is suffering from testosterone poisoning. And it's because Carl Sagan said that, I think we can listen to it without laughing. So it's important for women of South Asia. I've been to many South Asian workshops, and some of my loveliest experiences have been getting to know Indian, Pakistani, and Sri Lankan feminists and activists and scholars. And I think, though I may safely say that women's movement as we knew it, as our foremothers knew it, is unfortunately hibernating, that it's important to network across South Asia. And because I certainly feel the vibe, and I'm sure you do too, that in a region that has gone very hopelessly wrong and violent, I need not go into the details, we have to somehow buck up again, take up the sword, the pen, and march again. Whether it be at a seminar, whether it be on the streets, whether it be dialoguing with each other. And I'm so happy that some among the audience had already been to Bangladesh. I do hope many of you will come again. Now, yesterday I've given a talk at the Churchgate campus of SMDT, and that was about a particular text of Rokeya. And today for the memorial lecture, when I was thinking about it in Dhaka, though I had moved on, I went back to one of my basic works, because I hope you will excuse me for saying so. I felt this is an audience which does not know Rokeya too well. So I really have to do a basic introductory paper. And amazingly, and this I must say, when I was being shown the campus at Churchgate, I had an inkling. Again, you know, we Bengalis are so ethnocentric and inward-looking. We think, you know, Bengal did it. You know, Bengal is the reform movement, the women's movement. But while I was seeing the Hall of Fame, the pillars with the portraits of these illustrious women and men who were by their side, I just thought that there was a very rich women's rights movement in Maharashtra, which I personally need to know very much about. And it's a very proud legacy. So that is something, I think, one of the major things I take back with me intellectually. And hopefully I will be able to pass it on. I already posted it on Facebook, and many of my friends who are feminists, they all sat up and said, yes, it's so true. Okay, so today is a basic introduction. Yesterday it was discussing a text, a very radical text by Rokeya, on which Bonita Bakchi, Jashodhara Bakchi's daughter, has written a wonderful book called Two Feminist Utopias, Rokeya Sultana's Dream and Poddurag. I discussed Poddurag yesterday. And for literature people, it must have been very interesting. Today, I will do a more straightforward and still introduction to who Rokeya was and her works. She was really a very large personality, and it's not possible to do a justice to her in so short a time, but I'm going to try. Bangladesh, a country with a Muslim majority and a population of about 110 million in 2010, is a traditional society permeated by patriarchal structures which sanction on the whole female subordination and segregation. Poverty and parda lead to deprivation of education, gainful employment, sense of identity, and empowerment. Quote, the culturally prescribed and economically sanctioned subordination of women reinforces their inferior and dependent status in family and society, unquote. This is by Najma Chaudhry, the founding chair of the Women and Gender Studies Department, a very flourishing department in the University of Dhaka, where I also taught part-time for some time. Social conservatism is in its turn reinforced by religious leaders, relegating a self-serving misinterpretation of the religion, relegating women to a subordinate status to the private sphere. Culturally, ideologically, and economically, the home family is the designated site of a woman's life still in Bangladesh, despite the high development and achievements in mortality, female morbidity, and education, etc. Economically, women comprise about 48% of the population. It is a matter of debate whether participation in the wage-earning labor force and white-collar professions has brought in its wake empowerment. Women's political participation, too, occurs in the context of poverty, male patronization, and subordination in the highest level as a consequence of dynastic legacy. This, despite the fact that we do have a very esteemed and efficient woman prime minister. Because as feminists say, that the strength of the chain is in its weakest link, and we have to see whether the woman in the village has access to clean drinking water, to a cesarean operation if she wants to. Does she make decisions within the family? Is she burnt for dowry or for refusing to listen to a patriarchal diktat? So despite all that, I would not paint a very rosy picture, and that's why the relevance of Rokeya today. To start on a rather grim note, I don't know if you know here, Nusrat Jahan Rafi, a teenaged Madrasa student, was burnt on April 18th this year for refusing to respond to the advances of the principal of that Madrasa. When she did not, the principal let loose some boys, hooligans, who, with the help of a girl student, lured Nusrat Jahan to the rooftop and poured kerosene on her and burnt her. She survived for a few days in the hospital. And it's amazing. The reporters took her statement and she said this girl in a Mopassan town in Bangladesh, in her teens, who probably never, of course, I mean not probably, never had never heard of Simone de Beauvoir, and she didn't need to. She told the people of Bangladesh through her interview, her dying words, that I know I'm dying, and before I go into oblivion, I want my entire country, men and women, to know that they should protest against this kind of oppression. I do not want my death to be in vain. Let my death be registered as a protest against the cruel practices that men perform on women. These were her dying words, and we were all very, very moved by this. So in this context, we have to, we scholars and activists who try to hold up the women's cause, are subject to a lot of criticism. Of course, things have improved a lot from what it was 10, 20 years back when we first started doing our PhDs, that this is a fashion funded by the West. Of course, the stigma of being loose, unethical women is always there, lurking in the background. You're never free from it. So in response to that, I always, because I'm a women's historian and I have a lot of friends in literature, in anthropology, who are feminists, and I tell them that you really, all you need to say is that when you go out on the streets with your chola and become a Marxist activist, that's fine. But when a woman talks about women's rights and feminism, you pronounce it as an imported ideology from the West. We want to tell you that there was a very strong indigenous tradition of feminism, and one led and promulgated by a Muslim woman from the Muslim Andermahal. So just go on repeating, use Rokeya as a shield, as a banner, and you should be able to answer, give a very fitting answer. Among the pioneers, it would be historically incorrect, therefore, to presume that there was no resistance to the patriarchal diktat or norms in our region. We do have a rich tradition of women's reform, women's awakening, and feminist thinkers and activists. Among the pioneers in this area were several notable women of the 19th and early 20th centuries, Pandita Ramabai Saraswati, Sharala Devi Chodhurani, Sarojini Naidu, Savitri Bai Phule, Rokeya Sakawat Hossein, just to name a few. For the women of South Asia, it is important to trace their feminist roots. This journey will take them to the life and work of Rokeya Sakawat Hossein. By the time of Rokeya's birth, the British dominion in India had entered its second phase of colonization. As pointed out by Gauri Vishwanathan in her monograph, Masks of Conquest, this latter phase followed upon the initial one of direct conquest and was marked by the strategy of holding sway through cultural modes. And amazingly, this is something that has been depicted by Rokeya in one of her allegories, Muktiphal, the fruit of the tree of liberty, upon which I have written and which I've discussed elsewhere. In this new strategy, may I have water, please? Education and creation of the anglicized class of sympathetic Indians was of central importance. This served to mask the ulterior imperial motive of the conquerors. Thus, in the major cities of India, new schools and colleges were founded based on the English model through the medium of English, thank you, which had replaced Persian as the official language in 1837. As the indigenous system of education through the medium of English was transformed into the Western one, the first communities to avail of the education and employment of opportunities thus provided were the Brahmos and Hindus of Bengal. In the last decades of the 19th century, the Muslim community entered the process of quote-unquote modernization through education and women's reform. So we say that if Indian modernity started with Raja Ram Mohan Rai and the anti-sati movement, and the Bethune school was established in 1849, there was a caveat in the Bethune constitution that no Muslim girls would be allowed to study there. So 1849 was Bethune, and the Bengal Muslim Renaissance is supposed to have started with the publication of Mir Musharraf Hussain's Bishad Shindhu, or the Sea Ocean of Tears, around 1870. And it was accompanied in northwestern India, in Aligarh, by Sir Syed Ahmed's setting up the Anglo-Oriental Muslim College and the Aligarh movement. These all went together. And I don't need to go into it here. There was also a conservative, orthodox, reformist movement. I'm talking about the Muslim community based in Deoband. This was part of the Bengal Renaissance, which was launched by the intellectuals, writers, and reformers of Bengal. Though belatedly, this cultural and intellectual movement, which transformed the newly emerging middle-class urban elite, soon drew within itself, its arc, the leading figures of Muslim Bengal. It is against this complex historical, sociological backdrop one must view the career of Rokeya Sakawat Hossein, circa 1880-1932, writer, reformer, theoretician. Rokeya is perhaps the female reformer, educationist, and writer of colonial India whose life and career have been most thoroughly researched by Bengali scholars. Renowned feminist writer and Tagore scholar Ketuki Kushari Dyson, and I conclude with this again, has described her as India's first feminist. To evaluate this exceptional woman who emerged from the shadows of the Muslim Andarmahal to tread the path of 20th century social reform, one needs to place her in the context of the Bengal Renaissance and reform movement of the 19th century. She was born into a declining aristocratic landowning family in the village of Pairaban, Rangpur in present-day Bangladesh. But the site of her work was Calcutta, metropolitan Calcutta. The majority of Muslim landed gentry had seen its heyday by then, and the community as a whole was backward compared to the Hindu and Brahmo communities of Bengal. Rokeya's father, Zahiruddin Muhammad Abu Ali Sabir, once a rich zamindar, had frittered away his estate with his decadent lifestyle. Her mother, Rahatun Nessa, overshadowed by the patriarchal family structure of the day, was given to strict parda, an observance of tradition. Rokeya would have been a neglected child. She had never been to a school. Had it not been for the care and tutoring provided by her elder brother, Ibrahim, and sister, Karimun Nessa, Khana. Between them, they secretly taught Rokeya how to read and write, especially the language of the new elite, English. English was taught by her husband, and surprisingly, Bengali, because it was considered the language of the non-aristocratic class or the Atraf. Later, Rokeya's husband Sakawat taught Rokeya English, and Rokeya also taught Sakawat from Bihar. He was a magistrate in Bihar. Bengali. So we start to see at the very onset there was a reciprocity between the husband and the wife. But Rokeya was not destined to be a happy wife or mother. She soon became a widow, and she left Mongir in Bihar and migrated to Calcutta with a little amount of money that her husband had left her to establish a school, had told her. And she set up the Sakawat Memorial Girls School in 1911 in Calcutta, naming it after her husband. And it still exists in 9 Lord Sinha Road. It's a school now in Calcutta. She started the school on 16th March 1911 in Wali Ullah Lane, Calcutta, with just 8 pupils. And I had the good fortune to meet one of them, to interview one of them. She has, of course, since passed away. And my grandmother used to study there for a brief time, I think. She had already written one of her first pieces in English. She had written in English, Sultana's Dream, in 1908 by then, which was published at the encouragement of her husband from Madras in the Indian Ladies magazine. And I'm not going to talk about Sultana's Dream again, just this much, that today it is taught in, it is part of the syllabus of universities in the West. And my son, who typed part of my thesis, was excitedly told me in one of his rare calls that he heard a group of women in USA, they were discussing the first science fiction writers of the modern world. And Mary Shelley was one of them. And Rokeya Sakawat's name was placed after that. Because Sultana's Dream is a science fiction fantasy. Just let me say a little bit about it. Please read Bonita Bakchi's book, Two Feminist Utopias. It's about, and it shows you the colonial ambience, everything. So Sultana, a young lady, is thinking about, it starts off with, that I was thinking on the condition of my Indian sisters. And Rokeya, of course, used the word sisters way back in 1904 when she started writing. Bhovinigon. She goes on sisterhood, sisters. And she says that I was thinking of the condition of Indian womanhood, and she probably went into a trance when a young lady, Sister Sara, came to her and said, Sultana, I want to take you somewhere. So she went, and they magically landed in a country called Ladyland. And I don't think Rokeya had read Charlotte Perkin Gilman's Her Land. And so Sultana with Sister Sara was walking the streets of Ladyland. And at one point Sultana says, there's something very odd about this. I don't see any man. Okay. And Sara says, yes, you won't, because they are where they're supposed to be. Here, only women administer the state, they grow crops, there's a need for policing, they work in the chemistry laboratories, they teach, they perform, and the men are where they belong, in the Murdana, which is her sort of counterpart to the Zanana. But they are where they are, safe and happy. Okay, so this is a science fiction thing, and then at one point, this is Rukia's, it's a slim volume, but she builds this imaginary Ladyland. It was in Calcutta that Rokeya embarked on her career as social reformer, working tirelessly for the education of girls from the conservative Muslim community she lived in. She had to go from door to door. I told you my grandmother's sister actually studied there for a while, and she had to go from door to door to the Muslim guardians saying that please send your daughters. We do not teach them to be fallen women. They will be good mothers and wives. And I'm going to dwell on this a little perhaps later, that Rokeya had two faces. One, a writer, and a writer writing about patriarchy, and the other, a social activist setting up a school, because she didn't have a family to worry about. A school, and she said her school is her life's dream, and she would do anything for her school. She used to wear a burqa. She was an observing Muslim, but it's amazing how her imagination could go anywhere. So when she confronted the conservative Muslim community, and there is an article, I have written one, Professor Sirajul Islam Jyoti also wrote about Rokeya's strategizing about her circumvention. And she would say that, come, send your children to my school, your daughters to my school. We teach them to be good wives and mothers. And she carried the argument for female education. Her advocacy was so single-minded. She would even say they have to know chemistry in order to be good wives, good cooks. So don't you want to send your children to school? And they had to go in a bus with the parda all around it. So no one could hear the voices of the girls in the bus. So that's how she started with 8 pupils till the government recognized it and it became a government school. The prevalent attitude to female education in Muslim society had to be tackled by recourse to its sanction in Islamic scriptures by the liberals of the time, who were led by Sir Sayyid Ahmed. I have talked about it. And Sir Sayyid's follower, Sheikh Abdullah, had set up a girls' school in Aligarh in 1904, which still exists. And Rokeya did go to Aligarh at the Muslim Women's Educational Conference. The Andar Mahal, a Persian word denoting the inner quarters of a Muslim home where women and children were supposed to lead their lives, was Rukia's lot in childhood. This was also a social space though. Women in the Andar Mahal were said to be in Parda. Among the Hindu and Brahmo communities, this space was known as the Antapur. In 1916, this year I'm describing Rukia's career and then I take her works. I talk about her literature. In 1916, the many-faceted Rokeya founded what I would call one of the first NGOs, the Anjuman-e-Khawateen-e-Islam, or Muslim Women's Association in Calcutta, following the example of several such social welfare Anjumans. It seems she was inspired by the one set up in Aligarh. Okay. The main objective of the association was to enable destitute women to rise out of their destitution, etc. And they worked in the slums of Calcutta. On its board of directors, Rokeya had managed to recruit some of the most illustrious women of Calcutta, Muslim, Hindu and Brahmo. Lady Obola Bosch and Mrs. Hamid Ali, Sharola Devi were people Rokeya knew very well. There is correspondence between them. There's evidence, those documents exist. She was 52 years old at the time of her death on a cold December night. And here I want to say that 9th December is celebrated as observed as Rokeya Day in Bangladesh, Rokeya Dibos, the day of her birth and her death. The day of her birth is not known, so it is observed on this same day. And I'm very happy to be giving this lecture in the month that Rokeya Dibos is observed. She had finished her day's work going over the school's accounts. She had retired at about 11 p.m. and around 4 in the morning of December 9, she had risen to perform her ablutions for the morning prayers or the Fajr prayers. She suddenly fell ill and drew her last breath. She was buried at Saidpur in the Muslim cemetery near Calcutta. Okay, here she is portrayed, she was an observing Muslim, she was reading the Quran also, but I cannot go into details about her secularism. Very quickly, she seldom glorified anybody. She was a rationalist, a legatee of the Bengal Renaissance, but she wrote one poem to one of the revolutionaries. I hope you know about Khudiram Prafullo Chaki, yes. Okay? So she wrote Kanhai Lal, Nirupomo Beer, absolutely laying laurels and singing an ode to Kanhai Lal. And when she passed away in 1932, the Muslim League had already been formed in 1906. There is no affinity or reference by Rokeya to the Muslim League. And in Mukti Phal, it's amazing, I had done an article, the allegory I talked to you about. I do want to revisit my writing because the more I'm looking at it now in my more mature spectacle, I think that she says it's a political allegory. She never participated openly in politics, and you must realize that the Muslim community was a latecomer to the whole process of modernization. But she really did have deep political thoughts, I think, because she says that this is written in the context of the Congress split in Surat, in the so-and-so, and the figures in the allegory are each, I think, represent a political strand in the Indian struggle for freedom. Probin Dorpo is this British collaborator who eats marmalade and has tea and lives off British bounty. And he thinks that freedom is not worth fighting for. And Kangalini, it's very allegorical. Kangalini is Desh Matrika, who is suffering from a malaise, incurable malaise, and it's colonization. The malaise is colonization. She's in the last stages. And there, amazingly, there's no domestic scene here. She's out there in the courtyard. There's no husband. The husband doesn't figure much in Rokeya's writings, really. Neither in Rabindranath's short stories. That's a different story. So Kangalini is in the courtyard under a tree, dying away, and her sons, she has two daughters, Shumati and Shukunna, I forget. And her sons are saying that, mother, what? How can we cure you? And then the mother says that on the hills of Mayapur, it's an allegory, Mayapur is the, I think, England or the British administration, is the tree of liberty, and if you can get me a fruit from that tree, I will regain my health. I will come back to life. So each of the sons, Dorpo of course says that what rubbish, it's not a journey that should be undertaken. Then Probin, you understand by the name, says, let me write some more petitions. Let me try appealing to the goodness of the British. And I'm sure they will see our point of view. And Rokeya is being dismissing all this, very subtly sarcastic, okay? And so Probin just rushes off to write another petition. Now, Nobin, the new one, he says, no, this will not do. I'm going to fight. He's honest, he's brave, he's good, well-intentioned, and he goes, but he fails. And the Mayapur residents no longer hold the land in subjugation through arms or force. I was saying that Rokeya had foreseen in a way what Gauri Vishwanathan wrote. They play their Maya Bashi. They do it through the magic of their flute. And the final thing is Kangalini tells Nobin that you're very well intentioned, but your comrades are dying. You have a lot of courage. And of course it may seem a simplistic answer, but Rokeya never strayed from her mission and vision, which is include women. Which is women must be given their rights. So Kangalini says the secret of success is if you take the two daughters. And Nobin, Probin, Dorpo, all of them say what rubbish. And this is a sort of critique of the Bhadralok liberalism. Nobin, Probin, Dorpo all say that Shumati and the other sister, you have been given education. You sing songs, you inspire us. Why should you want to join this struggle, this hard struggle? What can you do? What are you women capable of? And then the women, the two sisters say, we will climb mountains, rocks, cliffs. We will climb creepers. We will do what you do, just as well as you do, if not better. And we want to be by your side in this, by your side in this struggle. We don't want to sing songs and write poetry. And Kangalini says that, I wish you would take these two. So the two, the ending of the allegory is, they set out and the two sisters join the journey for the fruit of liberty. And Kangalini says that now that the daughters have joined, and there's this line, Bharat na jagire, Bharat lalona, Bharat jagire na. If the daughters of India do not rise, India will not rise. That towards the end of Muktiphal. So Kangalini says that now I have some hope. Let them come back. Of course, she doesn't conclude it. It's not concluded yet. So This, I wanted to add this to the fact that she was an observing Muslim. So after she died, the honorary secretary of the school wrote in his report, "Today this childless woman, after devoting her life selflessly to the greater good, realizes society or government must take up the reins of the work she has done. The utter neglect from quarters she had looked up to has broken this woman." And Rokeya does say that I'm like the cleaner of the pot, the clay pot. It's a black pot, and I ceaselessly clean it. And the only reward I've got is my hands are black from the soot, but I don't know if the pot is any cleaner. But there were laurels as well. I'm saying this because yesterday a few people asked me what was the reaction to Rokeya. As evinced in this tribute by literary figure Abul Hussein in the journal Shadhana. Quote, "I hope readers of Sultana's Dream will be able to awaken the strength and confidence among women of their households. Mrs. Aris Hussein, through Sultana's Dream in generating the belief in woman's unlimited strength, has truly contributed to the immense welfare of society." Unquote. Her literature. Rokeya's literary output falls into three broad categories. Women's Awakening, where she formulates her thoughts on the contemporary and universal women's question. B, Muslim Awakening in Bengal. C, the Bengal Awakening. Her early pieces were marked by a bold and undiluted, this is the other Rokeya, not the social reformer, the writer. Her early pieces were marked by a bold and undiluted enunciation of the women's question. In Avarud Bashini, Dwellers in Seclusion, she presents 47 episodes depicting the irrationality and harmfulness of Avarud. For the sake of analytic convenience, let us take a look at Rokeya's major writings on women from the perspective of thematic categories rather than chronological sequence. These categories overlap, needless to say. So first, it is her concern was women. She says that women suffer a degraded status. This is something that you have to admit. So in her seminal essay, Stri Jatir Abunati, or the fall of women, or the decline of women, she writes, quote, and now I'm going to quote a lot, so just that you can get in vignette form a feeling of what she wrote. "In ancient ages, when there was no civilization or social borders, we were not such slaves. As man became more civilized, he started to exert his domination over women through naked force and intellectual craft. The society which created monarch and subject, distinctions between law enforcing and state authorities, that has also subordinated woman to man. They have subordinated woman through their physical and intellectual prowess." Unquote. It is this piece that, in this piece that Rokeya formulates clearly her thoughts on the subordination of women. She establishes the fact of subordination in history with a capital H. And I can't emphasize this enough because in this lies her radicalism and her clarity. Rather than any law of nature or religion, and uses the term slavery for the state women are in. Like modern day analysts, for example, post-Marxist feminists who add gender and culture, class, wealth as criteria of social inequality, Rokeya does not think that wealth alone accounts for the subordination of women. Quote, "Where destitute women earn their living through sewing or domestic service, slave labor, there too the incompetent man remains the husband or swami. And he who marries a rich heiress also lords it over his wife. And the lady doctors and other esteemed professional women also accept the submission to their husbands or lords, despite their independent income." This was all 1910 was a very, that decade was a very productive decade for her. A woman's heart, mind, and soul have all become enslaved, unquote. Her brilliance lies in the fact that she rejected outright any notion of the natural, biological, or spiritual inferiority of women and superiority of men. Having done this, she sought the reasons of subordination in historical evolution, thus replacing biology with history. So this is the next stage of the analysis. Women are degraded, and now depiction of degraded status. She has to like the great rational thinker she is, the theoretician that she is. No wonder Ketoki Kushari calls her the first feminist of India. It may appear too brief for us, but she was the first woman to logically think this out. So the depiction of degraded status, it's not just enough to say that women are degraded, in decline, obonoti hoyeche. So in these pieces, I've just got some of her pieces, Griho, which is the house, where she says the women do not have a house, or Dhangi, the other half. And some feminists in Dhaka say better half, lower half, husband, wife. Why don't you use the word Rokeya used, or Dhangi, the other half? But of course it sounds a bit, you know, imposed. You just can't go and say this is the other half. But that it is a feminist theoretical piece. So Griho, the home, or Dhangi, Mukti Phal that I talked about, Avarodh Bashini, or Inside Seclusion, Poddurag, the novel, Bhrata Bhogini, Brother and Sister, and Nari Srishti, Creation of Women. When she died, she was writing her last essay. She was writing an essay. Nari Rodhikar, Rights of Woman, which was incomplete. In her essays, addresses, her allegories, Rokeya untiringly draws pictures of how women are subordinated and robbed of basic human dignity through the institutions of family, law, education, employment, politics, culture, religion. In Orthangi, the writer goes about the task of illustrating the malaise which was her lifelong concern. In the opening lines of this essay, she writes, quote, "It is necessary to study the symptoms of an illness before treatment can commence. Hence, one has to depict the degraded conditions of the," she is quoting, "helpless race before remedies may be sought. In Stri Jatira Abunuti, I have shown my sisters that they suffer from the disease of enslavement and dwelt on its causes and symptoms. Now it is time to trace the impact of this malady on society," unquote. In each writing, she tackles the thorny issue of the women's question. For instance, in Griho, written in 1904, she makes it clear that the home is seldom, if ever, shared by the mistress, be she living in a humble hut or a mansion. Quote, "When we inhabit only a shed with a tin roof, or when that roof too is blown away by the wind on a stormy night, roofless we get soaked. At that moment we still inhabit our Lord's home. And as a queen when we inhabit a palace, there too we live in our Lord's home. So I say that we do not have even a humble thatched hut to call our own. No species in the animal world is as homeless as we. They have homes, only we do not." In Avarodh Bashini, I'm going to go for time, I'm going to go very fast now. The 47 episodes of Parda and the dangers of Parda are drawn from real life. In very quickly, I want to say that Rokeya, everyone is a product of their times, and she had to operate and work in her times and her society. So she had thought out this rather interesting and intelligent formulation of Parda and Avarodh. She says Parda is something, is modesty, something to do with the heart. One can wear a scarf, one cannot. It is an inherent emotional, intellectual, and spiritual quality. Avarodh is the perversion of Parda, where you restrict a woman unnaturally, unhealthily, and deprive her of her human dignity. So that allowed her to navigate the world of women's emancipation in a conservative community. She was always writing in the journals. There were always critics. She was facing that, and she was navigating all the time. In her only novel, Poddurag, which was written in 1902 but published in 1924, she portrays a sort of women's commune or ashram where destitute or helpless women from all of the major communities of India, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Brahmo, come to live and work. In tracing the stories of each of the inmates of the ashram, which she names Tarini Bhavan, and the principal of the ashram is Mrs. Dino Tarini Shen, Rokeya depicts how each woman became a victim in her particular society. So like the true Renaissance figure that she was, she offers solutions and alternatives. She just doesn't stop there. So quote, "It is not easy at first to rise from this stupor, we know. Muslims of India will declare a verdict of qatl, or death sentence, for us. And Hindus will pass one of burning on the funeral, on the pyre. And the sisters too are not desirous of awakening, we know. But rise we must for the good of society." So she was always sort of urging and invoking the women to rise and improve their condition. Her vision was far-sighted in that she also provided solutions like a true reformer. The solutions of cures to the malady she perceived were spelled out in her literature. These may be subsumed under the categories of education, wage work, consciousness raising, and solidarity. They may appear to us as a liberal feminist agenda, but that's what that was the boundaries, the parameters that she lived within. But she transcends that in her novel Poddurag. But it is a utopian text. Education is seen as the primary and central means of emancipation as it empowers women. But interestingly, here too, Rokeya goes one step further. Unlike the Bhadra community, both Hindu, Muslim, and Brahmo, she says again and again that education is for waged work. So this is the other boundary that she transgresses. So I say in my work that she transgresses the boundary of employment, you know, she breaks that, and the boundary of domesticity. In Poddurag, she says, she makes the heroine say that a marriage and a home is not the only path for a woman. And I denounce the marriage to a man I love, a life of fulfillment with the man I love. This is the protagonist of Poddurag saying in the last page, so that future generations of women can proudly say or think that there are paths other than domesticity for a woman. So she transgresses also. The one area she does not venture into is sexuality. A lot of people have asked me that, and I said, please don't expect Rokeya to do all your work. Way back in 1910-20. You do something also. Achha, now, she says about education, and I will then go to waged work. Quote, "Just as sunlight does not penetrate to our bed chambers, knowledge does not light up the chambers of our mind. This is because we do not have proper schools and colleges." Three Jati Rabunati. She goes back to the theme of schools and colleges. One may, of course, critique this overriding emphasis on education as a panacea for all social ills as simplistic, but after all, education was a major tool for women's emancipation and societal development and continues to be. Rokeya was remarkable in that she went on to the next logical step, that is waged work, for women as an ultimate goal. She realized economic dependence was largely responsible for women's subordination and pointed toward waged work as a means to empowerment. In this regard, she says, quote, "We shall do whatever is necessary to gain equality with men. If earning an independent living now is a path to freedom, then that will be our choice. If need, we shall become lady clerks, lady magistrates, lady barristers, lady judges. 50 years hence, some woman may be the sovereign of the land in her role as lady viceroy. Why should we not earn? Do we lack hands or feet or intelligence or any faculty? The energy expended on our husband's household could be as well spent on independent business." This is an oft-cited quote in Bangladesh. A final element in Rokeya's writing is a far-sighted perception that women need to deconstruct patriarchal notions embedded in their psyche. So this is also, she addresses knowledge production, which would be both for the outcome and cause of raised consciousness, which was termed Jagoran in that era. There was not really a movement. Rokeya has little to say about women and politics in the conventional sense of the term, except in that allegory. For her own and future generations, she has left behind alternative visions of a society in which women may seek refuge. The first example is the ashram Tarini Bhavan in her novel Poddurag. This must have seemed like a utopian vision, literally a refuge where women from all communities and classes and castes may live and work in dignity and sisterhood. In Poddurag, through the protagonist Zainab alias Aisha Siddiqa, Rokeya pens one of her remarkable denouncements of patriarchal culture when the beautiful and accomplished Zainab refuses to return to a loving and loved husband who had deserted her, if unwittingly. In Sultana's Dream, I have discussed this. Now I come to the conclusion. How should we evaluate Rokeya today in the light of the 21st century as it unfolds in Bangladesh or South Asia? Are we to look up to her as a social worker or as a writer and formulator of Bengal's feminist thinking? Can she be called a feminist then? What is her message for the women and men of the 21st century? History does not encourage glorification of personalities, whatever the measure of their contribution. Each person must be seen within the context of her or his time and the limitations imposed by region, class, caste, community, etc. Rokeya's school stands to this day. It created and maintained the new generation of Muslim women who participated and perpetuated the process of modernity. It was a cornerstone in the modernizing of Bengali Muslim women. Her writing had a wider reach in space and time, and as is the written word, became almost imperishable. As a writer, Rokeya could afford to be what she could not as a social reformer: open-minded, untrammeled, and honest. It is no mean task to gather one's thought and bestow it to a future generation in a manner which makes it relevant and entirely readable. She achieved this. Her writing is widely read and quoted today, and is being translated into many languages. Rokeya's vision was far-reaching, and though concerned with the Bengali community around her, she dwelled on the status of women in other societies and other times, as her writings testify. And she has this piece called Delicia Putta about a Christian girl. So we may call her feminist if we do. It really doesn't matter. The term did not exist then, but it is the content that we would like to dwell on. And I'm going to quote, "Readers, sisters," she says, Pathokgon, she knew she was writing, and she knew that through her writing, this was her outreach. She was reading out to the sisters. "Have you ever thought deeply on your miserable condition? What are we in the civilized world of the 20th century? Slaves. We hear the world has seen the end of the slave system, but have we women seen its end? No. Why are we slaves? There are reasons, and those I have enunciated above." She had many Hindu Brahmo friends, well-wishers and supporters. Her universalism in religion is clearly spelled out in her work from time to time. And I will just say this much, that she has beautiful passages where she talks about the unity of all religions. She likens it to a house, and she talks about the floor, the first floor, where many chambers, and then the second floor, then the third floor, and then ultimately it's just one house. That's how she describes religion. And as she uses a lot of Hindu mythology and allegories, and so that shows that she was very well read in Hindu mythology. It's amazing, whatever she wrote, whether it be a little about Charles Darwin, we don't see her missing a step, and that's what surprises us. And her secularism or her breadth of mind may be illustrated by just one example I'm going to give. And these are very tough times, so we scholars have to be careful what we say. We are often asked to take back what we say. And well, I think you know what is meant by that. So when she wrote Stri Jatir Avunuti, if my memory serves me, she had one paragraph where she wrote, all the religious books of the world are created by men. She said that. And she did not add any clarification, auxiliary, or a modifier saying, except this and this, except my religion or her religion. She just wrote that. And there were one or two other sentences. She said that if it had not been written by men, it would not have been so, the religious texts. The editor, it was published, and that's how we know we have it. The editor of the journal later told her that, Mrs. Hossein, you have to expunge this. I really cannot republish this. So she did, she had to. And of course now we expunge it before even the editor asks us to. We wouldn't even say it, right? I would only say it in a audience of women and some enlightened men. So, another quotation, even though the Hindu community was more advanced, no, this is Ketuki Kushari's comment about Rokeya that I started off with. Quote, even though the Hindu community was more advanced in the field of female education in Bengal at the time, the most radical revolutionary voice of protest among Bengali girls was that of a Muslim lady. Her name was Begum Rokeya Sakawat Hossein. Her thought was characterized by distinct feminist traits, in spite of certain compromises and hesitation. Is not Rokeya the first true feminist woman of Bengal as we understand the term today? Ketuki Kushari Dyson, Romindranath Victoria Wokampur Shandhane. This was published in 1985 and republished in 1997. And the book got the Prafulla Kumar Sarkar Memorial Ananda Prize. It's a beautiful book. I've read it. Today, as we look back, just to add here that when Ketuki talks about Bengal, we are talking about exceptional women out there in Bengal. And Ketuki singles out Rokeya. Today, as we look back at the work of this pioneer, 100 years after her first essay was published in 1902-3, we have to pause and evaluate her for the breadth and vision of her achievement and relevance. Many of the social ills she wrote about still exist, and that brings us back to Nusrat. In fact, they may have become worse. Some new ones have been added. Patriarchal oppression is alive and increasing through the new forces of right-wing extremism. True, as Rokeya dreamt, women have their MAs, BAs, PhDs. they grace the offices of judge, magistrate, even head of state. Nonetheless, as the strength of a chain is its weakest link, and none will argue that women of our country do not suffer from the negative impact of malnutrition, distorted religiosity, unequal legal and economic status, unfavorable cultural norms and gender roles, we are in quite an unenviable state. We are yet to shed the badges of slavery. Rokeya's first writing, Sri Jati Rabonuti, she had many versions of it. The first version was called Olamkar Na Badges of Slavery. Ornaments, she used this English phrase, ornaments or badges of slavery. And there is a beautiful documentary on Rokeya, which I worked with. We did it all voluntarily, and I will send it to you. I should have brought it. And there's a beautiful, there's a picturization of Sultana's dream, of Poddurag, that wonderful denouncement acted out by one of her very talented actresses. She teaches in the Department of Drama and Theatrics, Wahida Jolly. And in that there is this quotation. She likens the necklace, cheek, ornaments the badge of slavery. This was her, later she renamed it Stri Jati Avunati. So she likens the necklace to a dog collar. Then the bangle to that something cows and dogs are held imprisoned with. So every bit of the nose ring, something that the husband can pull you with. So every bit of jewelry, I mean, she does it with much more, elan than I'm saying, or than I'm putting it here. And so she says, sisters, because she had grown up in an aristocratic zamindar family where she describes this, I think in Avarud Bashini. She saw a new bride weighed down with tons and tons of gold jewelry. And she was the new reformed woman. She believed in, discarding jewelry. And later feminists like, there was this beautiful poster in one of my friend's house. She's a filmmaker. If I cannot dance, I will not be part of the revolution. So I think that later brand of feminists were not so averse to jewelry. But now when I see the Syrians in South Asia, getting up in the morning, weighed down by tons of jewelry from the neck to the foot, I remember Rokeya's essay, Olamkar Na Badge of Jewelry, that the cheek is something to weigh you down and keep you rooted to the spot. So she says, we are yet, we are saying this, we are yet to shed the badges of slavery. Her writings, her feminist thought, her contributions are still very relevant. Her objectives still elusive. As the 20th century unfolds, we have to reclaim our rich feminist past, fragmented as it is. The path has been shown by, great scholars and activists, such as the one in whose memorial we are gathered here today, and all our four mothers. So I think we really have to re-excavate that past tradition that has been bestowed to us, gifted to us. We do not value that gift enough, fragmented as it is, for it provides us with personalities and movements that have centered around the emancipation of women in varying ages, in varying forms. Thank you.
But beautifully depicting the life and works of Rokeya Sakawat. And as I was listening to her, and the way Rokeya could transgress many boundaries, I think I can see and draw parallel in what Neera Bain has also done. 70 years back, the kind of feminism, the kind of feminist she was, even a progressive woman like Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, she could not dare with it. So I think this was truly inspiring and very thought-provoking presentation. Thank you very much. And yeah. I'd like to request Professor Putul to felicitate Dr. Sonia Amin with a small token of our love. And Dr. Amin wants to reciprocate with some to the department. Thank you so much. Now I request Professor Vibhuti Patel to give her presentation address.
Presentation, and I think acclimatizing us with Rokeya, Sakawat, Hossein's other writings, because in the feminist circle we have been mostly focusing on Sultana's dream. But I think many other important contributions with Rokeya, Sakawat, Hossein made as an institution builder, her role in Anjuman-e-Islam, her role in Calicut Muslim University, and conceptualization of, because how difficult it was for her to bring Muslim women to the school, because initially they said that they would have they would be taken from home to school in a special buggy with cover, so that this community believed in segregation. So we have heard so many, when Anjuman-e-Islam group women in the 70s and 80s, they talked that how difficult it was for their parents to send them to school. So under very strict patriarchal restrictions that she had to work, so that we got to know of it. Another thing that we would like to say, that it is not only in West, but also in several Indian women's studies department, Rokeya, Sakawat, Hossein is being taught. In fact, JNU also has a special Rokeya, Sakawat memorial lecture. Dr. Zoya Hassan and all, they have instituted it. So that's very important. I think what she's saying about the role of our foremothers, that we have such a glorious history of our foremothers who were concerned about larger and some of the epistemological issues, and also the nation building, the main concern they had about nation building, and that those were the times where they worked for the freedom movement, at the same time they were social reformers. So I think that is a very important learning. And today the major challenge that we are facing is that this, in this consumerist society, where, as you said, that elaborate marriages, ostentatious marriages, women, the consumerist culture also is attracting women into just getting, investing in body, not in mind, because that's what the younger, like you have a research assistant in your department, the first salary she gets is that you can't recognize her next time you meet her, because there is a makeover. But question of critical examination of women's status and all, I think that culture has been going. We are facing a major challenge, even in the women's studies department. At one level, we have a very esoteric researcher that is also coming up in the women's studies. And at other level, we see that a lot of right-wing infiltration in the women's studies department, which wants to focus only on women's role as mother, or women only family studies, not to focus on women and their the subordination, what are the roots of subordination and her construction of knowledge for bringing the alternate scenario that is not happening. And that was the work which both Neera Amin and Rokeya Sakawat Hossein have done. So I think in this context also, all the nuances and all the various episodes of Rokeya Sakawat Hossein's life as well as the writings, I think they are extremely important for us, and I think we should take it to the new generation. And I think the style of writing of Rokeya, those small simple sentences, the imagery, the kind of symbolism, metaphor in Rokeya's writings, I think it would appeal to even school children, no? If we can take it in a different forms, not only documentary or even the short stories, even now there is a lot of new forms of rap and I think modernizing, yeah, comics also. I think it's very important because many of us in our youth, we go like Marx in his own words or Freud in his own words, or this is what those series that we had. I think we should take it at that level only, not only for the intellectual discourse among the super specialists or among the scholars, but I think we have to pop because every society needs icon, and we need icon like Rokeya Sakawat Hossein or Neera Amin. So I think these icons are very, very important. Otherwise, they will go for Bollywood icon. I remember going to Bhavan's College on 8th March, and there was a poster competition on women in development. There were 80 presentations, and 79 of them were only of Bollywood stars and serials. Only one student made a poster on Shubha Lakshmi. I gave her first prize, and I asked her what motivated her to make a poster on Shubha Lakshmi, MS Shubha Lakshmi. She says every morning her nani would listen to Suprabhatam. And she said, what is this every day you are listening? And she told the story of Shubha Lakshmi, that under what adverse circumstances she came up in life and how she dedicated her life to nation building. All the property that she owned, she used it for the social development, and and that inspired her to make the poster. But imagine if we don't tell our younger generation about such heroic women, then obviously they will see that whatever is just dumbed down their throat through multimedia channels and Netflix and Amazon, they are going to emulate that only. So I think it's a very important challenge for us. And that's why once again I'm reminded by Neera Amin that we need to take women's studies to community, to all sections of society. And that's why we had to have, like she is the one who motivated me that we must write in Gujarati. In fact, when we started this Nari Mukti feminist journal in Gujarati, we used to, the Nari Mukti was decided, the content of Nari Mukti was itself a study circle. Whole day we would spend, we would discuss various important issues. From women from six cities would come to one member's house. So one meeting would be in Neera Amin's house, second one would be in Surat, third one would be in Udwada, fourth one would be in Anand, fifth one would be in Baroda, sixth one would be in Ahmedabad. So whole day they would sit together, and there were women from four generations, Neera Amin being the oldest. But we had a 15-year-old school girl also who would be in that meeting, and all of them would discuss. And then the content of the journal was decided. So there was so much of ownership, 16 issues that came out in Nari Mukti. And we did not dilute the rigor. We had a series on patriarchy, so Leela Dubey, all the stalwarts in women's studies, their writings were made available in Gujarati. Then we would have a fiction, we would have Gharangdani, a heroine in our veranda, in our doorstep. So all the women who were fighting heroically in the women's movement, their profile from right up. So I think this is the way, if we take feminism, then I think it would reach out to people. And I'm sure today's talk would inspire many of the young students and scholars sitting here to join our journey. And we all will pick up. It would be our collective journey. Thank you. So now the floor is open for questions or any kind of intervention.
Where men are locked up inside their houses so that women can be outside free. lock up the men. We ask them not to come out of the house after 7, so that women can be free, because they are the perpetrators, right? So that is what I'm talking about. That's the first thought I had when you started speaking about Sultana's dream and Rukhaya's. She was indeed a visionary. She spoke about this over 100 years ago. She wrote about it. But this, how do we change this? We are still discussing this. This is still valid feminist dystopia.
Absolutely. You just switch on the TV today. And then I started, because I was coming here, I started reading Sultana's Dream again, all over again. And when I started reading it, I said, my God, same things are happening. Same things we are seeing on the TV today. Nothing seems to have changed. But just wondering what could be done, that some sort of a change, some sort of a rethinking.
Or what is it?
It's not easy.
What is it that we are not doing in the
What is it that we are not doing in the Yes, sir. Exactly.
आपने जो बातें की हैं बहुत ही डिटेल्स में और रुकैया सकावत हुसैन की जो एक जर्नी रही है एक मोर देन 100 ईयर्स बिफोर एंड नाउ इट्स रिसेंटली अगर हम दोनों सिचुएशन को देखें तो लाइक सो मच प्रोग्रेसिव मुस्लिम वुमेन्स मूवमेंट फॉर द एजुकेशन एंड सोशल रिफॉर्म्स मूवमेंट बट नाउ सिचुएशन इज वेरी कंट्रोलिंग फॉर द अंडर द religious institutions and the more patriarchal dominations controlling at the sake of and protection for the Muslim women and because of the living for this in this country for the minority. So much like very like restrictions and so much the India and Bombay and some other parts of the state, we have so many minority institutes. But these are the institutes not like talking about a progressive movement for this, those are the contribution for the gender rights and different kind of progressive movement. So we as a feminist group in Bombay and our work is most of the Muslim women's rights issues. So we are facing the challenges for that this kind of minority institutions. They are very restricted for the gender rights issues, any kind of issues talking about the, not only for the sexuality and other violence against women, but even that if you talk about the education. So now is the education, it's very under the religious framework and now it's a minority institutions. They're very much controlling for that the name of the education's information. Everything is under the framework for the marriage, career of the marriage, how to make the good women and good Muslim and Muslim women. You know, like this kind of so much dilemma is happening. So we are facing some level of this. Even this Aligarh Muslim University, I was there in the 2 years before, and we had elections about the gender rights and the and personal laws. And this the last moment, our lecture was they're not allowed to this kind of discussions. So even so now it's changing so much. Whatever is a progressive institutions, progressive minority education systems, but still, but we can't sit in nothing any hopes. Some level we are trying, some level some good professors, some good management, some good institutions, but the number is very less. So this kind of we are facing and challenging. Now we are looking for this Saffronization's country. Saffronization's So I'm just saying in this country we are living in this Saffronization stage. And so much controlling for the education, minority education and most of the Muslims' education institutions. So Muslim education also to showing our patriotic to the state, how to showing the our secularism. So the secularism is not talking about the criticism for these patriarchal and the education system, the state systems, what kind of, so some level is very silent. So I'm just like, I'm really really happy to you are here and discussing these issues and the best thoughts and journey. I'm so glad that this kind of discussion is happening for these some other minority education institutions. So most of the young women also listen and understand this today's scenario. So thank you so much.
Also that what can be done to change. Yesterday one of the questions was framed in a very interesting way that when you talk about Poddurag and a feminist utopia, all this is utopian, unattainable. What is attainable? That is true, and it made me, it jolted me into thinking, that's right, you know, we are thinking about utopia, talking about it, theorizing about it, whereas really, as Rokeya would have liked us to do, as Neera Desai ji would have liked us to do, to address what's going on today. I have no answer to that. I'm as perturbed as you, but there must be something somewhere. No, there cannot be a disease without a cure or some alleviation of the pain. I was following the debates around the rapes, right from the ones in Kashmir, you know, Kathua, to Priyanka Reddy, and Nusrat Jahan Rafi. I talked about the girl in Noakhali. And I was talking to this, discussing it, I think, last night with a friend, an Indian friend, a man. And he was saying, a feminist, I think, a feminist man, he was saying that this clamor for a murdana, locking them inside the inner quarters, will not happen and it's not a feasible solution. This clamor for hanging them for the death sentence, is that the solution? And naive or simplistic as it may seem, one of the solutions, which is what Kamala Bhasin ji also says, catch them young from school, they must be socialized, that why this mindset of violence? So just hanging four men, would that solve the problem of violence? There's something more rotten and deep-rooted that is eating away at the heart of our society. So I think that could be a solution. We really have to change our trust, our thinking, and I think you're sort of on the right track, that how do we carry the message out of the seminar room and the classroom and into the minds of young boys as they're growing up. Here, I don't know, this is just, I'm thinking very casual, when it just, it's a thought. I'm thinking and asking myself, having a conversation in my own mind. When I about censorship, I know it's one wants to be politically correct. I know a lot of friends who want to be politically correct. But I am alarmed, especially after the opening up of cyberspace, that a 10-year-old girl or boy or 8-year-old has instant access to pornography. Has instant access to anything, something sordid, murder, blood, gore. I'm very disturbed by that. And it's no use saying, I don't know why those against some form of guidance, I don't want to call it censorship. I know this is a very loaded and dangerous term to use, surveillance and censorship, and I would not use it. But some form of guidance, some form of sense must prevail. And I do believe in the case of, I think the Priyanka Reddy case, the men were watching some pornographic material, and there are companies which thrive on such a business. So we really should, I think, get together and brainstorm, and I would love to have your thoughts on it. Do you agree with what I'm saying?
No, definitely I don't agree.
You don't agree?
No, I don't.
Achha. And
I'm very scared of the kind of guidance you're suggesting.
No, I was just seeing this post on Facebook. The objectification of the female body, do you not think so, that it is objectified?
Absolutely, but that, you know, sometimes women themselves want to objectify also. I'm very scared of the kind of censorship or guidance that you're referring to in the current environment. I mean, I definitely don't...
No, that is also true. I'm just thinking of that dress code and...
I'm definitely not for that.
Moral policing. Something to that, to what you were saying.
I also have something to add.
I would not like that I would be able to speak freely if this is not recorded.
No, nothing is recorded.
But
it's just like values, you know, where you have to respect another person, another's rights, like your own. That is one level. And the other is that over that long period, you know, civilizations develop. And these are all the various values that come with it. For example, human beings are equally violent and non-violent both. How does one deal with one's own inclination towards violence, towards unrestricted sex with anyone, anywhere? You know, these are all ways in which a civilized society grows. To me, the erosion is one of democratic norms, rules, which goes with erosion of some degree of civilized behavior, you know, which we have learned over very long.
How would you redress it?
I would find, and this leads me, I would feel that whether it is Dalits or tribals or women, I think the struggle to restore democracy becomes a major task in this kind of scenario. Of course, with emphasis on rights of minorities, rights of Dalits, but you know, it has to be seen as part of erosion of democracy.
But there is democracy. People are able to come into power through democracy.
No.
What
does
democracy do for us?
It is not in principle. It's only in letter. It's not in spirit. It's not in spirit.
For the common good.
It is not for the common good. The principle of democracy is being greatly eroded in all of our society, yours and mine. The second point I wanted to make, this is just love thinking. When we call somebody like Rokeya, when we call her a feminist, of course I have no difficulty with that. I sometimes wonder whether giving them these labels actually limits their contribution. I hope I can explain it. You know, recently I saw an article which says how Lalit of Kashmir, this great saint poet, and you know, she was like Neera. Lalit is a celebrated great saint poet of Kashmir. This person calls her
attribute.
This is an attribute. They were much more. And they were like we know how Renaissance figures were. They were a lot. And she is a feminist, she's democrat, she's secular.
Humanist.
She's a humanist. I'm going to say that.
I just
that.
Want to add to you that, thank you for giving me the opportunity. What you just, I didn't know that there, on television there was this discussion about putting men behind bars and all that. One of the most beautiful quotations of Rokeya, the most relevant quotations, is something that I didn't get the chance to cite, is that Shomaj ekti shokot, I almost cite it everywhere, Shomaj ekti shokot, tar duti chaka nari o purush, ekti achal hole, so society is a chariot of which the two wheels are man and woman. So if one is impaired, the chariot will not run. She of course says it in order to advocate women's education, etc. And I agree that it is Sultana's dream is an exception or something. It's something that she wrote it. And she showed it to her husband, Sakawat, when she was in Bhagalpur, sorry, not in Mongir. And Sakawat read it, and it is documented. He said, a terrible revenge, you know, by womankind. And we assume for 5,000 years of domination. But Sakawat then sent it to Madras. And it's interesting that it had to be published away from her tent.
You know, from the tent, Neera is a colonial nature. She would be a very, quote unquote, ideal speaker. Just much more than a speaker. It's not, just being categorized into a speaker, but of course, it's continue the discourse further. I have Professor Patel, but the last minute we requested her to decide on her act, and she agreed. The reason being that our Vice Chancellor at the last minute refused to come because she is the one who was supposed to preside over. So if you see the poster has her name printed and all. Then of course I thank all the well-wishers who have come all the way. And I look forward to your continuous, this support in such difficult times, especially for us and especially for RCWS. I thank the student, I thank my colleagues, I thank my staff, and I think that is the end of this talk, and on behalf of the department, I invite everybody for a cup of tea and snacks outside, and we hope that this dialogue continues. And last but not the least, I would also invite everybody for the Dr. Ababai Warrior Lecture, Memorial Lecture, which will be held sometime in the second week of February. So I hope that I get an equally warm and receptive audience then. Yes. Thank you.